Glitch2 is a plugin that is pretty insanely awesome. It's super capable and it's a multi-effector. In the old days, I didn't use Glitch1 that much, but it was mainly because I didn't understand it. And it was kind of more of a mismatch between my skill level and what I could actually do versus the tools that I could wield. So I got the opportunity to get a beta of Glitch2, and it's pretty fantastic. So I just I wanted to get this to support DBlue, who is the developer of this software, and mainly just, you know, show him some appreciation for the work that he's been doing on the Renoise team. Even though I'm going to spend the money and vote with my wallet for Renoise 3, I still wanted to just, you know, kind of give the team a little bit more of a kind of like a tip jar kind of thing, I guess. But this plugin is way beyond what I had expected to get as a return for my investment. So yeah, trying some new formats here. Made the webcam window bigger and I can turn it on and off with keyboard. So on, hello, off, on, off, on, off, on, off. So kind of goofball. So yeah, I think it's gonna be better though, because I found that in the videos that I had made before that the screen was covered up in some pretty important spots. This, I think, will be better. Anyway, yeah, this is a multi-effector, somewhat along the lines of another company's multi-effector named Sugar Bites, called Effectrix. And while it's not a direct competitor necessarily, because I'm pretty sure Glitch came before Effectrix, there are similar pieces of it in essence. But they're different plugins entirely. Effectrix has different effects. It's just a different sound. Those Sugar Bites guys are awesome too. Really awesome programmers. But this is just I know there's similarities, but I don't feel like it's 100% an apples to apples, because I think the intent behind the designs is different. So anyway, without too much further ado, I'm just going to start tweaking and explain some things. So I'll turn off the webcam so that my giant head goes away and you can just take a look at the stuff on the screen. Okay, I'll see you in a bit. So in the program, there are lanes. This is the basic layout, right? So you have lanes, and then they are on a horizontal timeline, and you can increase the number of beats within the sequencer area and the number of divisions per bar. So these are bars, I guess. Excuse me, and these are beats. So I'll put it back to the smallest I can get it. So you can also go all the way down to 1 and 2, which can provide some interesting effects. Now, disclaimer mode, I'm not exactly an expert on this plugin. So a lot of what I've learned is through experimentation, and so just know that I'm not an expert and I don't claim to be, so I might misspeak. And by no means is that, should my opinion or my what I say be taken for, like, you know, law, basically. Just a guy making a YouTube video, and I'm not an expert. But one of the things that is interesting about this particular plugin is it didn't come with any presets. So you'd click down here and it would all be the same. So let me just show you, because it's kind of important. Also, let me show you what I've got set up here in live. So I have an audio track with nothing on it and an empty glitch. Right, so this is what it comes out of the box. There's nothing going on here except this random looks like 8, whatever these are. So this would be 1 beat, 2 beat, 3 beat, 4 beat. I think these are bars, and I think these would be a quarter note, but anyway, I'm just gonna grab, this is from Propellerhead's Reason library. And I used a tool to extract the refill. So yeah, bad me, I know, whatever. But I like these sounds and I don't like to use reason for everything, so whatever. Point being is that these sounds are some that I know, like that I've grown up with over the years through Reason's library, and so I kind of know how they work. So if I play, you can hear that it's just randomizing every time, and this white symbol, or white outline, is telling us visually what is actually been chosen for the roll of the dice of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different effects. So, pretty cool. I mean, that alone in itself is pretty nifty, but it can get even better. So there's a lot more things that you can do here. I just wanted to show you what it looks like when you start it. Also, remember this is a beta, and I got access to this from the developer when he emailed me personally to say thank you. So that was cool. And I really respect the developer a lot, and I appreciate this opportunity to have access to this early software. So very cool. Really, really nice guy. I didn't have to do that at all, and I wasn't expecting it, so just for the record. Anyway, enough about that crap. So for now, I'm going to open up some presets that I made here. And you can see I've made several. I've got like a multi-bank here, another multi-bank, and then I created a bank for each of the different different effect types to try and leverage them in a way that's more plug-and-play. Because this plugin is super powerful, and there were no presets, I just thought maybe that's a way I could, you know, assist and give them some help. And even if they're not used or whatever, I'll still offer them up on my website, which is getting redesigned, by the way. And also, there's going to be a grimjack.com website at some point in the future, and I'll probably have a whole other lot of things to say about that, and I might even record some of my process of how I build that website. Right now, it's using a technology stack that's different than what I probably want to do. So anyway, more to come on that later. Point is that I'll make these presets available somehow. So I'm just going to load the first multi-bank here. This is the lane I've turned on a modulator in this preset, and if we click on it, it'll expose an effect tap down here, and you can see one of the cooler things about this new beta is there's more color coding. So as you click through the various different effects available to you, you get this nice outline. The original plugin Glitch was probably one of the most inspiring GUIs that I've used, just for example, I was really influenced by it, and I think so was a lot of other people in companies, including Ableton. So these knob types here, you can see all over live, you know, so this is how they, I think this plugin was one of the first to implement this kind of knob. So anyway, a little bit of backstory there. Maybe I'll do a comparison at a later point, but with the old version. But anyway, yeah, so this is the modulator. And you can feed the plugin MIDI, right? So I've got a Synplant loaded on this track. Fucking another awesome plugin. I love Synplant. It's amazing. My daughter and I were playing with this the other day, and she was programming synth sounds using this plugin, and it was pretty remarkable. So there's a whole other video that would maybe come on that. So, but anyway, the point I'm making is the plugin can receive audio. So I'm going to MIDI. It's obvious it can create receive audio. It's an audio effect. But I'm going to send this here and then Glitch, right? So I'll turn on that. And as I press keys on my keyboard, you can see that it's changing the scene, right? So here, 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 here. Those are octaves that I'm sending. So in this case, this preset has only one at the very lowest. And since I have a chord, excuse me, microstation, I can't easily send it that, actually I can, hang on a second, one moment, let me see if I can get into the settings real quick. One of the things that sucks about this keyboard is I can only that's actually not what I want to do, I don't think, transpose is not the same. MIDI. Vocal control, clack. Like I can't, I mean, I can only go up or down a single octave, it looks like. Yeah, that's right. And they don't have octave controllers, like octave buttons to control, you know, shifting around for MIDI. So I can get a little bit lower, 25 instead of 37. And actually, you know what? I just thought of something. I'm being a little obtuse. Live can help me out here with its MIDI routing. So there's a MIDI effect I can use for this. So let's put that in play. Actually, I don't know if that will work. I'll try it. We'll see. Because I think that I'm going to stop talking and try it. So, MIDI effects. Pitch. Let's try just dragging this guy in on my in here and go all the way down and see what we're sending here. Okay, so, yep. It's processing it through. So, Live is processing it through the track effect. For the MIDI, and it's actually working, so I don't have to worry about my keyboard being crappy about the octaves. So I'm going to take this down to one, so I'm going to send it a note, and it's adjusting it by negative 128 semitones. So let's go, I think my keyboard, let's just set it back to default, and the lowest I can get is 37, so if I go minus 36, that should be one, right? So now the lowest key on my keyboard is reaching that range. So that's nifty. So, right, so as you notice, I hit a key and it's changing it. So in the same way that like Artillery by Sugar Bites was like a multi-effect that you can use to control things more with key follow in mind, this lets you use the concept of scenes, and you can do, this is all one big preset, by the way. So you're noticing that this isn't changing here as I change the key that I use. So really you have tons of flexibility every single sequence. I mean, you can change everything. So like, let's go here. This is the first key that I hit. And I'm gonna just play the audio here. Right, so that's what that sounds like. But as I use my keyboard to send new MIDI notes, I can just jump to different scenes. So like real quick, I'm just gonna show you something really fast. We'll go into it a little bit more detail, but I wanna copy the whole thing. So I'm going to copy this, I'm going to go to this, I go up an octave, hit another C, paste, right? So actually I need to do it here. This is, I think these, actually I need to do it here, the scene, yeah. So I paste the scene, which is going to have, and we'll explain this a little bit later, but scene is the effects routing in the sequencer setup. So as you tweak a knob, like if I do this and change the depth, if I paste, it's going to include the effects. I can also just do the effects individual of the sequence, or the sequence individually of the effects. Anyway, so let me stop the transport real quick, just so I can kind of not go crazy with that sound in my head. But now I'm pressing, as you can see, these two octave keys, C1, and it might not even be C, I'm really dumb with MIDI note stuff. But so like, anyway, the point I'm illustrating is everything can be different. So this is a different scene, take it down to 1 and 2. Right? So everything is changing. That's a hugely flexible thing, which I have not taken much advantage of aside from one preset, and I tuned the modulator, and that's kind of where this whole long talk is headed towards. So let me open up that, right? So as I press keys, and actually I want to turn off my pitch because I did it. I designed the preset without using that pitch MIDI routing thing. So, but as you see, I'm changing. I basically manually went through every key on the keyboard that I had on my MicroStation, and I mapped the key with a frequency that is the standard tuning. So you can get a kind of tuned modulator. So let me play the audio. And this is, you can do things like that. It'll sound better on a different source. Like drums is not the best. Drums is not the best for that. So let me find something better. So a long time ago, I bought a group, there was a group buy thing going on for Sample Fusion from ImageLine, and you could get all of their CDs because at the time CDs were the best way to get them because we didn't have super high bandwidth back then. So you could get like 15 CDs for like, I think it was like $80 or something, and they had a deal on it. So I got it. I drank the Kool-Aid. I don't use these that much, but they come in handy for things like this. So I'm going to open up Dream Pads. I think some of the light pads are pretty cool. Right, so here's something that doesn't have a whole lot of tonality on its own. Actually, what I would like to do instead of that... No, it's fine. It doesn't matter. Ignore the clicking. But now if I play notes... So that was a bad example. I guess it needs more harmonic content, not just noise. Maybe this would be better. Also to note here, this is only a modulator. There's also an oscillator on board with this particular effect that I'm not taking advantage of. So I'll turn that up in a second. So this key right here, let's go this one. But you see the issue is if I go and press another key, I have to tweak it each time, and there's no like copy to settings functionality. There's a live rack. Anyway, it's pretty cool because this particular oscillator can be passed through the other effects inside of Glitch2, so I feel like I lost a little bit of the focus of the what I was trying to talk about, so I'm going to try and get back on track there. Okay, so back to what I was talking about. So you can get kind of like a comb filter sound out of that. Turn it back on for this one. So let me turn on my pitch so I get back to the default. So the default scene is 0001, which is like a key that I couldn't hit. Remember, so I had to turn on this pitch thing. So this is the modulator. So let me just run through some of the presets that I made and walk you through it, and we'll go over the whole structure. But yeah, that's basically something that I can add a little bit more of a bottom end to the beat. So you can tune this also, right? These files are mono, so just be advised. That's why it's on. They're old still, all old too. So, so here we have a generic beat that we're just messing with. And you can see that here we're turning on the modulator with no effects, because this lane determines what is happening on the plugin, and then the mix control up here applies to the whole thing. So if I turn mix all the way down, it's overall, this is global mix. As I turn it up, you can hear that we have full wet now. So it starts with modulator in the first beat, and then has a gap, another piece of it goes into re-trigger a bit. We'll go into all these different effects, but yeah, it's pretty freaking capable. So let me just cover some basics before we go too much farther, because it just makes sense to. So apologies for the stream of conscious behavior that I have with these kinds of recordings, but I feel like the spontaneity of it all makes it just lends more validity to it, and it just seems like it's the unplanned, you know, side of it. I'm not making money on this, So I'm not like making tutorials professionally or anything, and I feel like it's more fun for me just to be like a tweaker and an experimenter and not so much of a scripted presenter. So just that out of the way. So the mix right here is honor, you know, this is the global, all of it, every effect for the entire mix. And you also have pan and volume in the same way. So if I play this again, I boost volume. Also have a limiter on the master. So that's going to affect the transients a bit, but it's also going to make sure the audio doesn't clip. Right, so as I boost the volume, it's overall everything. Double clicking or control clicking will get you alt clicking, or is it shift clicking? No, just double click, I guess. Yeah, so just double click will get you back to the default setting. And then obviously pan, right? So these are global parameters for the entire thing. And so in terms of signal flow, it goes top down, pretty sure. So modulator sent into the tape stop, sent into free retrigger, reverser, stretcher, lo-fi, distortion, gated delay. One of the things that Deep Blue had said that he was going to add, sorry, I'm gonna get drinking milk. Was the ability to reorder these in any fashion that we'd want, so we could send delay into distortion, for instance, which is pretty awesome. Can't wait for that. So anyway, and then each of these different effects have different parameters down here, as I mentioned, but obviously the randomizer doesn't have anything that affects the audio directly, but instead determines the probability for each of the other effects to occur. So modulator, right? So you have... It's not immediately obvious, it wasn't to me anyway, but if I turn on the filter, every effect has a filter, first of all. That's part one. So every effect has a filter, and it's unique to that effect, which is pretty sweet. But what wasn't clear to me was that all these controls would be enabled even if this was in the off position. So, but that is the case. So I can turn down. Let's turn down the delay. This is easy to understand with the delay. I'm just going to extend it. So now it's running the entire time. It's got individual mix on every single one of these controls. Also, if you're tweaking the Numua beta version, you can use solo to disable all the others. Right? So you can really hear that that's happening. And I think all of these controls, aside from these two, which are obviously tied to the filter, are available on every effect. So if we change the mix, so it's, you know, more of a dry signal and just a subtle bit of the delay, you can also pan it, change the volume of it at this stage. And so that's pretty cool. So let me just every single one of these effects has that module, so it's super important when you figure it out what you're doing. So back up to the top one, like I said, there's different filters, low pass, high pass, band pass, and band stop. So you can get pretty creative with this, and it's after the effect, obviously, hence filter, right? So other thing is there's a bunch of these little buttons. So file opens up a menu. This doesn't exist in the current public version. This is how you rename it, copy and paste the presets, initialize, which is really nice touch. I really love plugins that have a NIX, just love it. And then you can modify it so the sequencer is quantized against your host timing for this. So like you won't change something inside of here against, you know, the clock. So it's always going to stay locked. And that's handy. And some of the presets that I'm going to illustrate later show that. But then down here you have, you know, the same kind of button for a scene to load and save. And then these locks determine like what gets randomized. So in this case, you can lock the editor to the current scene and ignore the MIDI notes. So if I go like, let me put that other preset back on real quick. Right, like so I'm sending notes, you can see in live. Notes are actually being sent. If I turn off this lock, now you can see it's actually changing it. So I put the lock back on and pick again. Actually, I'm not sure what happened. I might have just found a bug because all of my stuff went away there. Hold on. Let me reload this bank. Just a minute, sorry guys. So, right, so 37 through, let me turn off the MIDI pitch. So 37 through 97 have things. If I go past, nothing, right? And then 36 also should have nothing. Right, because I can't reach it on my keyboard by default, so I'm not stoned. That's actually happening. Okay, so let's turn on that lock now and see if we can break shit. So I turned on the lock. I had a MIDI effect that was going out of range to where it was before. So all the way down, all the way up. Lock is cool. Just send it down, all the way down, all the way up, all the way down, all the way up. Take off the pitch thing. I'm not sure what happened there. Is that in the same preset? I don't know. Okay, so I need to stop that so I don't go crazy. But yeah, so that's what that thing does. Copy and paste the entire scene, which you saw was effects and sequence, right? So the scene contains the effects on all of their settings on the knobs and various buttons and everything. And then the sequence itself also, so if I were to do all, you know, this kind of thing, it contains both of these things. So let's just copy and then let me init and then I'll paste. And you can see that everything got copied in the same way. So that's pretty cool. And you can init at any of these levels, which is also sweet. It's really good workflow. So yeah, I'm gonna let me put my plugin bank back into a normal state. Right. And the same is true for copying all effects or all sequences. And then inside of each of the effect lanes and the effects themselves, you also have copy, paste, init, randomize, and mutate. So let's go over these buttons a bit. So let's use this fill as an example because it's pretty obvious. So there's a mutate for the entire scene, which is going to mutate effects and sequence. You can mutate just the effects, or you can mutate just the sequence. Now, I seem to recall in the old version, you could adjust the amount of mutation, and maybe that's what these things are for. I haven't tried it yet. So let's just mutate the entire thing and see what happens. So what we should expect is the sequence should change up a little bit. Mutate, not randomize. So it's going to be inspired by the previous copy, is the idea of a mutation. So where randomize is more just crazy, it's the full range of values. Mutate is an inspiration from the current. So let's go ahead and mutate the entire thing and see what we got. How can you not love that? It's awesome. Like, so inspirational. And this is just a shitty little four on the floor mono beat. Like, also, it should be mentioned that you can change the seed value. And so, as you saw in the default state, he's using a little bit of a throwback to the old school here with this elite, 31337 elite concept. But you can do whatever you want here. It's just a number that seeds the random number generator. So you could do one, right? And then rand, and that's the seed that it would, well, actually, it's wrong. If you randomize other things, it will use that seed. This is going to create a new random seed. If I do one, let's see what mutate would do. So it's just lower, it seems like it's changing the seed in a lower effect. And I could be completely wrong about how that works. So let's ignore that for a minute. But randomization is way more different. Like, you can see this is drastically different every time. I didn't do anything. I clicked that button. I hit init. Okay. So I'm hitting init everything. Init one time up here, and then I'm going to rand. Pretty awesome. So one thing I would like to note is that the beats and divisions, when they get randomized, there's some pretty cool stuff that happens here. And there's a term that I don't remember what it was called, but it's about like parallel sequencing or something. And I learned about it from when I had my old copy of F Expansion's Tremor. They had like polyrhythmic. Is the term polyrhythmic sequencer? But basically the idea is that, you know, four on the floor, you get four and four. So if I take this down to four and then I do four, we're gonna get more predictable outcome against the actual beat, because the beat is designed as a four on the floor kind of thing, right? But you can add like a polyrhythmic or whatever the hell the term is when you just adjust it by a tenth. So now the effect has a different sequencer length than is actually compatible here. So like things are getting reset in odd ways as the thing starts from the beginning. So let's do it from the beginning, and you'll see that, you know, up through here, we're gonna see normalcy, right? I'm gonna remove this in a minute. So this will be to the four on the floor pattern, but as soon as we introduce this fifth one, which is against that other grid, we're gonna get some pretty interesting stuff, and it's just perpetual after that fact. It might actually sync up with itself at some point, but it's really interesting to do. So keep in mind that the init is going to give you four and four here, which is good, but also it's less happy accidents, I feel that way. So just be mindful of that. So let's randomize again. So here's one, right? So five. So it's changing every pass through. That is pretty cool. Also, it's pretty obvious that you have this thing, this glitch plugin is fed from the host clock. So if you sit here and play stuff, if you play around with stuff, like let's say you have a Simplant, right? You're like, I want to send a glitch to it. So let me grab a copy of glitch and paste it in, and then I'll load my bank here because there's some other things. I just want to show different material pass through the same plugin. So let's move this one down, and this is the beat one on the left top, and the other one is down here. So as you're playing, you're like, oh wait, hold on, helps if I turn on the synth. Let's use an init and then just do random across the board. You might think, well, why isn't it doing anything? Because that's the dry signal. That's the dry sound. You don't hear a difference, right? And the reason is it's not actually sending the messages to these other things because it's not playing. And there's no independent like playback in the sequencer. It's all slave. So that's something to note when you're actually sitting around trying to figure out like what in the hell is going on with the routing. Okay, so yeah, back to the beat copy of it. And I promise this is going to be one of the last times I reload this bank. Oh, that was interesting. I don't think I clicked the about. Maybe I did. So, right, so that's kind of like the basics of how it all works. Now I'm going to just walk through some of the presets and show off some of the things that it can do. And keep in mind, I'm no expert, but I was able to get on with the plugin within a short amount of time, and I felt like it was very inspirational, and just for that reason alone, the price of entry is pretty good. The plugin I think is around $80 or something like that, I felt it was worth every cent because of the inspiration you can get from this thing, and also its utility. So I'm just going to kind of go through some things and explain as I go. So let's go back to our shitty little beat. All right, so you guys have seen the other stuff. I don't want to go too much detail there. But this is an example where I just wanted to take crappy little regular beats, right? I'm going to turn on with glitch and without glitch, right? So here's with glitch, without glitch, dry, snooze fest, with. Pretty interesting. So, pretty cool. And then passing through some other pieces through this other sample material through the programs. idea of this preset was like you could have something going like normally here. And one of the ways that I've been using it also is with resampler. Start recording, right? So let's hit stop. Let's just start recording. So now we have a beat that is really boring on its own, but we've really quickly passed it through and given it some variation with a fill. So let's go back here, I believe, is what I would like to do, and I'll just play that back. So first time through, dry, and actually you're hearing a phase issue because this was being monitored also. But here's the fill. So pretty cool that you can just really quickly knock stuff together like that. That's one of the ways that I find this plugin is inspirational. You can just print it, you know, print what you're hearing. Because a lot of the times there's unique things that are going on in the way that the sequencers might be not locked to 4/4, for example, or the delay tails or something have to build or whatever. And so it's better just to print it, you know, print it to tape with that resampler. Right. So let's put this back. Happy accident moments. Pretty cool little bongo shuffle riff here. Like, I would never in a gazillion years myself come up with that sound on my own. I just would not be able to do it. I just would never do it. So this is like a gateway plugin. Like, it will unlock your inspiration in many, many big ways. So I'm just going to keep going through here. Same way on the same material, so play that sound at the end here. It's not in this. Right, and is it just a matter of it being out of sync? That's amazing. So, right, like, there's no way in hell that I would ever figure out how to make that without this plugin. Not in a gazillion years. Actually, let me turn the global sequencer back on so I can get a clean cut when we do that print. Let's do that again. Right, so what we did there, I'm gonna turn off monitoring on this track so we don't get that phasing sound, but also there's some latency because of the way I have to screencast this stuff using DirectX because my AZO driver doesn't work with my camera software. So be advised that you're gonna see lag. So if I even hit play, you can even see it visibly, like the program is doing stuff, but we can't hear it for a short time later. So you could take a simple beat and just get many, many different variations out of it really simply. And this is just one way to use it, obviously, but the printing to the resampling is needed here because, like you heard as I was going through the different presets, it kind of goes out of sync or something happens where like the buffers don't jive and so you don't get the same desired outcome for each one. So that was that sneak one. So let me do, actually, let me turn off the FM metronome. Where's the stupid menu at? Where's count in? There. I'll probably regret that decision later. And I'll be like, how did I, what happened? But whatever. I want it to be more immediate. So let's do that again. This time we're going to use this particular clip and we're going to record to this slot. So one thing that might not be obvious, and this is something I picked up in live and it's that's really cool, is you can use discontinuous selection. So holding down control, I can create many things to happen at once. Obviously, in this case, doing something with this is going to only let one play through because it's only one track, but I can click here and here. And what this will do is if I hit the enter key, it's going to play this and record here. Pretty sweet. Oh, and it would help if I was hearing what I wanted to do. Oops, I didn't want to do that. Right, hold on a minute. Please wait. Okay, so let me turn on, I'm using a function key F1, 2, 3, 4. That's the track by default, the key bindings for turning tracks on and off. So I'm just gonna hit enter again. And this time I want to use this beat as my audio source. So let's do this one. Just keep having some fun here. That's pretty cool. So they're all like the same inspired by sound. Like you still have the same like stutter effect for all those beats, but you could hear there was a totally drastic difference between them all, even though it's a similar pattern. So you can kind of get inspired pretty quickly and go off the in the deep end. Be advised. So that's pretty flippin' awesome. I mean, what else can you say about that besides hold on, because it's getting interesting. Okay, so that's just one example, right? Let's turn that back on. Sorry guys. So here's an example that you can emulate scratching, sort of. Like, I mean, it's not perfect, but it's scratch-ish. Like market, 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 market. Right? That sounds cool. So let me explain this effect a little bit. It's the tape stop. In the reverser in tandem. So if we just solo tape stop, it's slowing down and starting back up. And then we have the reverser, which actually slows down. It almost sounds like it's slowing it down at the same time. So the combination of those two things creates that phenomenon of scratching. Right, here's another example of just, it's fun, like just draw in here, make shapes, like experiment, tweak it. All of these pre- presets in this bank were done originally from scratch. I didn't use a randomizer, so it's all intentional. That's without any effect. Make it interesting. So yeah, it's pretty amazing what you can do with this. I'm going to keep going through, but I wanted to illustrate different sounds through it. So we have those pads. Let's just put Glitch on there. Let's do it from the beginning with one of these. So I didn't get a chance to get into this preset. This was a really happy accident. And so this one, you're going to have to see my big head about for a second. So I was going through and I was like, okay, this is neat. I started, you know, like, so is you should know that the way that this bank is structured, these are sequential learning. So like first, second, third, fourth, etc. This is like, okay, me starting out, I don't understand how this effect works, but knowing that, you know, talking to Deep Blue and email that we could tune certain effects and stuff, and it hinted to it in the manual. And here I'm like, okay, let's mess with it. And so like I got down to this point and I really had one of those happy accidents. This is amazing. I would never in a gazillion years have built this on my own. And so I know I keep saying that, but, and I don't want to bleed about it over and over, but this is pretty stunning. So one thing that I need to know real quick about this is that the way that it's set up, there's an oscillator. So it's independent. Like even if I don't send any sound through it, let's hear it. It's just the internal oscillator, right? So that's the only thing that is stimulating any of this stuff, and it's just getting passed through. If I turn that down, there's no effect, obviously, because there's nothing, there's no trigger, right? So, but just keep that in mind when you hear what this thing sounds like and what it does, because eventually what will happen is the sound will be overtaken by the internal oscillator, but it's like a gradual bleed almost. It's like a phenomenon, and I don't have any explanation for what's happening. Aside from the delay tail with the feedback is overtaking the entire signal eventually, but it sounds pretty flippin' awesome. So let's just hear it. So you can still hear the drum beat influencing it, but it's pretty evident that there's a pattern behind this madness. I'm such a nerd. This is like nerd heaven, audio nerd heaven. This is so fucking cool. Like, here's an idea. I haven't tried this. I'm gonna try this right now. I'm gonna pass a glitch to a glitch. So I'm gonna try having nothing going on until the last half of this piece. So I'll have a. This will be interesting. Let's try this. I'm gonna move this so I can get more than one going at a time. You're gonna hear randomization going on. Get rid of all that shit. Hey dog, I heard you like glitch, so I put a glitch in your glitch, so you can glitch while you glitch. So I made it longer so that we can have. I want it to happen like here. I want to do something funky or interesting. And I want to reset it, actually, because I want it to, I need to be in sync and I need to figure out where it actually starts. There's this subtle, like, beat, like, idling sound that sounds, like, really nasty and mean. Basically here and here, so I want to just fuck with it. Inspiring this plugin is, I had intended to go through and just explain this preset a little bit each step, but I just, you know, got inspired, and that was, I didn't even think about the idea of passing a glitch to a glitch, and holy shit balls. Cinematic groups. I can't remember remember the name of the guy who put it out, but these are fucking awesome. Like, it's just a Bollywood soundtrack thing, but like, really? How can you not, like, is that this is one of the standbys that I use for just messing with stuff. I'm also going to, I'm just going to pass this through a little bit and just play around a little bit. The output, so let's throw on some glue. ZZG is 0 0G. I just want to try adding a few more of these guys in, just see if we can find any any more happy accidents here. Yeah, that's cacophonous. That's getting out of there. Cool. So yeah, sorry for the diversion. I just got inspired and I wanted to mess with it. So I know I didn't hit it that time. I think live is having issues sending clicks elsewhere, but okay. So that patch, let's dissect it a bit. So oscillator gets sent into the retrigger module, which is doing 64, 16, and 4. I just turned off the wrong one, like a Durka Durka. Right, so it's coming through here, modulator first, and you heard that if I turn the oscillator down, the effect is less intense, like that pong sound. Should also be noted that you can double click or just single click actually into any one of these and type your value. And he's got really good sane checks on a lot of these, so you can't like put in like 3000 and you know it's gonna break the plugin or anything. So it's going through the retrigger, which I'll go through, you know, soon in a minute. This can be a long video, So, and then it hits the stretcher, which is actually a granular effect. So let's... That's just the stretcher. And if we mess with it, you can see it slows it down, change the grain size. I think it only affects it when it's got a little bit more liquid there. I don't have any envelope on this right now in terms of like modulating the depth of the grain size, but you can put it on. I think it's an envelope follower, I'm pretty sure. And you can hear the smoothing making a big difference, so it's got really picky. It's much more rounded. Pretty sweet. So this is a really nifty effect. Also, it should be noted, you can click this and you can randomize each sequencer lane. Pretty inspiring. Also, in the actual sequencer, you can, there's a tooltip that pops up if you hover, first of all, and in an empty area. At least it did a moment ago. Right. So left click and drag to draw blocks, middle click to split or join, and right click to erase. So middle click, middle click, middle click. So you go here and just slice around and stuff, and then right click just gets rid of them. Let's put this back. So we've tweaked that a bit, but yeah, that's kind of how it works. And then you just pass through lo-fi here. So it's giving that like low res sound. And it, that's also been used by distortion. So lo-fi is getting passed into distortion. And then the whole mess goes through a gator. So it's like closing the gate on the amplitude. And then here's everything's getting passed through delay with this setting. And so, one of the things that I didn't even go over yet is the possibility of automating these in your host. So, right? I mean, holy crap, all of these are automatable parameters. Pretty sure. Let's just test our theory. Right? Global mix, automatable. The delay line feedback, automatable. Modulator, FM release, automatable. Fucking everything can be automated. Filter type. Obviously, maybe some of these steps can't be because, like, you know, how could you anyway? How could you? But all of the knobs for sure. So, holy shit. That's amazing. Because reasons for like this. Where's the button? I don't do this that often. Let me see how I can do this then. So this is going to start recording in the selected scene in all arm tracks. Ah, I have to arm the track like a dill rod. I didn't do that. Like a dill rod. Yeah. Whatever. Make a lot of promises that I don't keep. So let's arm this biatch. Word. No input for you. So I have a clip, and it's only got so much stuff, so I'm going to unlink the envelope, and now I can automate. Forever and ever. Sorry to be a goofball. I am just pretty inspired right now. Let's get this board up again from Go. Instance, put it back to the way that it was supposed to be. That's the way it ought to be, yeah. I thought you could clear the envelope. There you go. So it's only one of them that got cleared, though. I gotta go through all of them. Clear. So, anyway, that could be pretty awesome. One of the things that Effectrix has that this plugin doesn't have is modulator lanes, but I think it's one of the things that Deep Blue wants to add in at some point.